Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of the, well, let me start that again. Welcome back to another episode of the Physically Distanced Study Time. Today on the live stream, what we're going to be revisiting is some half sorting. Now, we've all seen variations of it in movies. It's not very common, but it is starting to become more common. And I want to look at some of the ways that you can take your longsword and use it as a wrestling tool and a lever. When you're looking at the sword, we actually have three weapons here. The first of my three weapons is my sword for striking and cutting unarmored targets, peasants. So I use my sword for hacking. The second of my three weapons is the dagger. And that's when I reach up and I grab the sword by the blade, and a gentle distance for you to grab it by the point is about the same length as your forearm. You will see some manuscripts that grab it up closer. You'll also see some that hold it down closer to the forte. For what we're doing today, we're going to want to hold it so that the length of the point behind your weak hand is the length of your forearm. And most of the medieval daggers were about the length of your forearm, the rondelles, ballock daggers. So they want them to be about that length. And that means that when you're doing this, you have the same length to wrestle with and to strike openings. And here's the, come a little closer. So there's the length of a dagger. And it's a good general rule. And one of the things I tell people here at my school all the time, we look for our rules. We want to understand the rules. Because once we know the rules, what do with rules?
We break them.
We break them when it's tactically advisable.
And we understand what we're breaking.
And the consequences if I break them incorrectly. So the second of my three weapons is the dagger. Now, when people talk about half sorting, they are using this end a lot. This end can also be used. It's not as long as my forearm, but it's pretty close. And so this becomes a dagger as well, meaning I can strike with the pointy end or the beady end.
Blunt.
I like thing. Beady.
Beady is actually a really good way of putting
so
it.
So I can do either end. The third of my three weapons is the hammer. And that's when I'm gripping it like this. And I've turned my sword into a pickaxe. So I can come through and strike. And with that, I can either strike with the quillen or with the pommel, giving it more of a bludgeoning, or I guess a beady.
Beady.
So my three weapons of the longsword are the sword, the dagger, and the hammer. Understanding these three tools, these three weapons in this one tool, allows me to move through them when the circumstances require it. When we have sword, it's more like kayaking than wrestling. And what I mean by that is, if I'm in a kayak and I'm sitting down in my kayak or my canoe, and I have a double-ended, horse stance. I have the double-ended paddle. If I put the paddle into the water and then pull it, I'm just going to blow out my shoulder and I'm going to be tired before I go very far. So everything with this is I put the paddle in the water and then I push the other end. Put that in the in the water and then push the other end. And when we go into half sorting, it's the same idea. If I hook my opponent's wrist, so put your sword on here. So no,
okay.
This way.
Okay.
So I've hooked it here. If I come down and I pull, be strong.
Okay.
I can do it, but it's going to cost me a lot of time and a lot of effort. And admittedly, that hurts. However, if I do the same thing, I end up here and I just push my pommel to him, I can break his structure without putting pressure and hurting myself. So when you're half swording, it's not that I'm pulling or that I'm pushing. I'm using the other end of my sword to manipulate the side I want to move. If I want my point towards me, I push my pommel towards him. If I want my pommel towards me, I push my point. You can see how that works. What we're going to do today is we're going to work on an entry. So we are both starting in two-handed sword position. Now, I've heard people say it does no good to hit somebody in armor with a sword. Yes and no. You are correct. I'm not going to be able to cut through that armor with my sword. However, you can ring their bell by hitting them with the sword. And as soon as you hit them in the head or you hit a piece of armor and maybe it tweaks just a little bit, now you've retarded the amount of motion they have available to them. Now you can do other things. The only way to kill a man in armor is to stab through the opening. I cannot cut through it. However, I can cut into the armor to create the opening to get the stab in that I want. So we're both going to start in a long position. We're both in armor. You got to imagine, we're both in full armor here. So we're in here. I swing at my opponent. He goes to cover that because he still has to think about it. He can't stab me because I'm covered with my sword. And then as he goes through, I'm going to go to a half sword to stab him in the armpit. Let's switch sides. So I come through into the armpit. My footwork for that is I pull my point back. But you'll notice I'm leaving my hands in place, because even if he stabs me, go ahead and stab me. I'm still safe from that. And then he's given me a lot of options. So I come through. I step towards my left side. As he covers, I pull my pommel back. And this puts me in a guard called upper serpent. Then I step forward, and my whole body drives that point into his armpit. And that's how I bust through the mail. If I come through and I just do this, I'm going to bruise him, but I'm not going to break the mail. But if I drive my whole body into that, I am going to bust through the mail. Do you agree?
I would, yeah.
And that's not so ticklish there when you get that point.
It really isn't.
So let's do that again. Nice okay. And slow. One more time.
Yes,
I stepped in the wrong timing. That's what I want.
Ah, that's nice.
But what if he doesn't just stand there and instead he tries to stab me? And that's where we're taking this. So we're in here. I pull back. He goes here. Now I'm going to go to upper serpent, but with my pommel forward. And that leaves me in this position. He's not going to stand there. And I can't pommel him because why not?
I've got something in the way.
Not even that. Move your sword.
Oh, you're at a distance, yeah.
I'm at a distance. However, what I am going to do, because he's not going to leave his sword there, I'm going to push my point towards him with a step to my left. Ready?
Ready.
And that, turn this way, hooks his wrist from here. Now, just because I have his wrist hooked doesn't mean I've won this advantage. My next step is to step, you okay?
Good.
Right in between his legs. So my left foot is right behind his, no, you're fine. His left foot. Ready? I'm going to hold you up.
Okay.
And then, let me take this out. From here, I would go back up to upper serpent. Can we do that again?
Okay.
And I'm going to go really slow, but I'm going to go to our upper serpent.
Got it.
Really slow. Ready?
Ready.
Oh, I went. So from here, I step forward and I go to upper serpent. And that's how I throw him off balance. So I'm doing two things here. You okay?
Yes, sir. Perfect.
I'm doing two things here. I am using my sword to manipulate his shoulder and his wrist. But what else am I doing?
You're also stepping through my invisible legs.
I am, and I'm giving him a hip push to break his structure. That makes it much easier for me to do this.
You've broken my structure at four locations in that entire move is what I'm feeling.
Yeah.
So, and we haven't even factored the one set of, you just push me down and I'm wearing what, 60, 70 pounds of steel on my body?
Yeah, and you have no support because your head is down and then over the ankle.
So there's one break there. There's the break of my arm, of the structure of my arm when you rotated that up. There's the break of you taking away my stance and the structure of my feet on the ground.
And the fourth is me pushing your hips out from underneath your head.
And there's the fourth one there, yeah. So I don't have anything to stand on, literally.
Let's do that again. And I'm not so worried about him cutting me from short guard. This is a thrusting position. And because I understand it's a thrusting position, I don't need to worry about the big blow coming in. But I know he's probably going to thrust me. So I come through. He sees that. I use my foot to set that aside. You'll notice. Can we do that again?
Mm-hmm.
I pull. No, but not yet. I pull back. Then he stabs me. If I don't move my feet, he's going to go straight for my throat. But as soon as I move my feet, his point goes off. I continue the movement with a step forward in here. That pushes him out of the way. He retracts. I pull it down. I'm going to put my hand there to protect his neck.
Appreciate it.
Then I step through. And you can see all the control I have. Let's do it one more time.
Okay.
No, I don't want to do that. Never mind. I was going to, without the swords, walk into you, but I don't want to put you down.
Okay.
So, let's switch sides, please. Because if I just walk into your hips when you're in that position, what are the chances of you staying up?
I'm being dumped on the ground. There's no chance of me standing up.
And the nice thing about this is, at no point do I give up my structure or my position. Let's do that again. And we just walk right into him.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, and this time, you good?
Yep.
This time, you still don't know what's going to happen.
Okay.
But I want you to not just stay there.
Yeah.
Right?
Keep moving.
Yeah. Ready?
Ready.
Oh, look, he opened up space. I missed his wrist. Turn with me. This way. I've got his arm on my leg. My point is at his throat, but he's armored. That's okay. Put your hand over your throat.
Know exactly what you're going to do.
I push forward until I hit him with my hand. Then I push my pommel down. And there goes the throat.
Which is really funny because my system there, when we clash in that spot, I went to pommel under you with a step outside your right shoulder.
Yeah.
And you... your switch to High Serpent there drove me wide out.
So not only is it an offensive action moving into Upper Serpent, posta serpentino soprano is what it's called in the Italian. So Upper Serpent not only launches the attack, but it also defends. I'm going to do it wrong here. Because I want you to see this. This time, I'm going to do the exact same thing, but this time, instead of pushing my pommel forward, I'm going to pull my point back. Because I'm trying to get from here to get my pommel up. So, let's slow.
Yep.
This is going to suck. Ready?
Ready.
So I come here, and there it is. And now you have the full advantage, don't you?
I do, yeah.
And let's switch sides and do that again. The reason for that is because I pulled my point back, I left no real movement with my right hand. So, ready?
Ready.
And he can just push it out of the way. Let's go and do that same thing again. Now again, that pommel to the teeth. If I'm wearing a closed helmet, it's not going to hurt me. But what it is going to do is rock my head back. And then the next thing I need to do is step to get my feet underneath my head. And that's the time that he would use. So let's do it again. You do the same thing.
Exact same thing?
Exact same thing.
Got it.
Ready?
Ready.
Oh. Put your hand under your neck.
Mm-hmm.
Now rotate. Look how my leg is right behind his leg. My arm is on his shoulder. Ready?
Ready.
That gives me... are you sure?
Yeah.
I'm going to pull on my point.
Okay.
Watch his body move. Go back down.
Okay.
Watch his body move. Watch how it moves. See that whole body move as a unit and hinge from the waist up? You okay?
Good.
All right. One more time. This time I'm going to do it the other way.
Okay.
Now when I push my pommel down... You all right? I can tell I did it right when he smiles like that.
Yeah.
What'd you feel?
The other one there, you just straightened me up. And if I've got a...
Gorget or
Avantail. The Avantail is the word I was looking for. On that spot there, I'm going to thank you for standing me up. Yeah. Because you're standing me up here, right? Look at all this wonderfulness that you put here, right? Stand me up.
A little bit more.
Yeah.
There we go. Ready?
Yeah. Hey, thank you. Okay. I appreciate that.
What? No. One other thing I want you to watch is watch his head. Watch the angle of his head. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Did your head move at all?
No.
Go back. Now I'm going to push my pommel down. He already knows what's coming. When I push my pommel down, watch his head.
Oh.
Look at the angle that gives me. Now, from here... He's going to be trying to fix his body, and I'm just going to step forward and take his hip out from underneath him again.
I love my job.
So, it's
I love
my job, too. It's important to remember that this is not a muscle action. This is a leverage action. As we're doing it, I want you to... Think about using one end to move the other end, not by trying to manipulate the side you want to move. So it's important to keep that in mind. Now we've seen a couple different variations of this action. Why were they different each time?
Because I did something different.
Right. And I'm still going on the same baseline. But because he's a living, thinking human being, I don't have complete control of his response, but I'm continuing in the action I want. Now, I want to take this and I want to show you how I can use this as choreography. I had somebody ask me if I have theater training, and not a lot. I've done some stage choreography, but most of my experience is on TV or movies. So the choreography I'm talking about is more towards film, less towards stage, because we can manipulate the cameras and the special effects, whereas we can't necessarily do that on stage. So let's do that again.
Okay.
Now, you know exactly what's coming. We're working together. As I come through, I'm going to walk through, and I want you to just take a knee and then fall down onto your back.
Yep.
Are you good for that?
I should be good for that.
All right. So we come through. I begin. He attacked. I cover. I push this down. I pull him out of the way. He drops down and then sits down. And then I come through, and then he blocks it. Right? Scoot towards me. There we go.
Chiropractor.
So now, we're both in full armor. Who has the advantage? It depends on what the next part of the story is. So for now, you're going to win this bit.
Okay.
What are you going to do?
Well, I'm on the ground. I'm sitting here. What would be a great story add-on? What about throwing your weapon to the side and throwing a stab at you right there?
And then I can get back.
Mm-hmm.
But how are you going to get up in time?
There's the thing.
So that makes it very difficult. So let's do that again. I'm here. He blocked that. With your leg, roll onto your side that way. Same thing you did before. No, keep that leg down. Okay. So you're taking my knee.
Okay.
Go ahead and roll.
Ah, and now I'm coming up, and I throw that at you. He scared the space. Yeah.
So this is a way that we can combine the historic actions with the choreography to tell the story. This time, I'm going to win. This is the end of the fight. You'll just lay back down so I don't need to pitch down again.
Oh, that's really nice.
So I'm here.
Boom!
Drive it into his head. Now, this is where special effects come in. I drop down on each of his thighs with my knees.
I'm not that flexible.
Hold on. So that's where we hear a pop and a scream, then my knife comes out and I drive it into his face. They're doing a movie of a book called The Last Duel. In armored combat, almost every fight ends on the ground with knives. And if I can damage his hip flexors, how much more control do I have of the whole situation?
You have so much more control over the situation.
And
you've removed half my ability to do anything, even on the ground.
So now he's just going to be swinging his arms trying to protect himself. But I've created that pain to give me something to give him something to think about. So there's one option. Let's do another one.
Okay.
This time, I'm going to be in open iron door. And he's going to throw a cut into a thrust to stab me in the shoulder while he's moving this direction. So when we look at armor, depending on the era, and that's an important point. So 15th century armor, I have what's called a spalder, and it covers my arm here, the outside of my shoulder. Then I might have a bezague or a rondelle that sits over my armpit over mail, and then I have my breastplate that cuts in this way. And it is a very wide open because I need to have the flexibility to move my shoulders. So your targeting is this area right here between the deltoid and the nipple. That's your targeting.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm in open iron door and you're going to be successful on this one, that's what he's, and because he's hitting me with that step, let's rotate. Go ahead and push through.
Okay. I was about to ask you, okay?
Yeah. Right. He's pushing that point directly in.
Like he was driving with his step to punch through the mail, I'm driving that thrust with my step to go through the mail as well.
So, I dislike that. So, I'm going to use a pulsativa from Tutta Porta de Ferro, open iron door. Go ahead. Then I'm just going to let go, step forward, pommel strike. That turns his head. Now I want to bring my point back online. I don't do this. I don't move my point around. I move my pommel. And look how that just lines right up. Let's do that again.
Okay. Please. Ready?
Ready. I'm not going to move. You're going to hit me.
Okay.
Nice. Go ahead and do it again. Push through. He has to push through because I need his motion and his body coming this direction. That gives me the advantage. If he's not really trying to hit me or selling it for theatrical, I can't do my action as well. This goes against our natural inclination, which is to get away from the sharp pointy bit that hurts. I'm doing my pulsativa, my counter strike, and stepping into his thrust.
Ready?
Ready. and then I just continue it. That puts me back down here into what's called true cross. But I don't just do this, I do it with a step. Boom. Then I pull my pommel back. Now, I want to talk about that strike. If I lay my pommel across his jaw, he is not going to be standing there. He's not going to move a lot, but he is going to move. Right?
Yep.
Let's go ahead and do that again. Check measure.
Check and measure.
Good. Okay. Boom. And then I drive it in with my... And then this position... You know what position this is?
This is, I do not remember this one.
Posta Sagittarius. Guard the archer. Look how it's elevated. Now, I usually teach it like this, but that's because I've set it up for this. I'm still in that same position, aren't I?
You're in the exact same spot.
Let's do that again. Check measure.
Check and measure.
Good. Boom. And I'm driving forward with my whole body. But he's smart. So he covers that with his left arm. That's when I go back and I pull my point behind my head. And then I push my point towards him. Come this way. Then I push my point towards him again. And then I walk forward. Basically, the secret of half swording is use it as a lever. So I don't want to move this end. I want to move this end to control the other end and keep moving. If you stop, you've given your opponent what?
Time.
Time. And you've also given them, not only can they use that time to attack you or do something to you, they can use that time to readjust their balance. However, if you're not giving them extra time, but they're using their time of counter as the time of readjusting their balance, that means you have a free beat to do whatever you want to them, which is what's so fascinating about time and why it's so much fun to play with and manipulate your adversary's tempo. Can we do that one more time? But we'll do it from this side.
Yes, sir.
So I'm in open iron door. Check measure.
Check and measure.
Yeah, you're a little bit too far away.
Yep.
Do it again. Because when this hits, I want to assume that this is going to drive right through my shoulder and stop on my scapula. That's kind of what we're going for.
Okay.
Right.
Then that's right about there.
Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah,
there's that measure line there.
So now when he does it, I do my pulsativa. There's my strike. There's his cover. I step back, and I still got all of this. Now, one of the things that we're not seeing in this is gauntlets. Can you go back?
Yeah.
Right here. So he covers with his arm. As I come through, is that right?
Yeah. I cover. Because I covered.
As I come through and I slide on his arm, let me slide on your arm. I'm going to hook his gauntlet, and I'm just going to be pulling his hand, which is locked in his gauntlet, and that gives me the ability to really manipulate him. Because when we take this to wrestling, I manipulate a joint. I manipulate one joint specifically to control the joint above it. So if I'm going for a wrist grab, I want that grab at the wrist, but not for the sake of the wrist. I want that for the elbow. If I go for the fingers, I'm doing the fingers to move the wrist. If I move the elbow, I move the shoulder. Shoulders are connected to the head, and where the head goes, the body has to follow. So, okay, I'll not try to go into a dancing career.
Well, I already said sorry for the fact that I'm laughing so much in the middle of this nice, serious sword fighting class.
That's exactly, well, not the laughing bit, but manipulating a joint to control the joint above it. That's what we're doing when we half sword. The pokey end into the other guy is only the completion of the action. There's a whole bunch of stuff that has to line up for that to work. And any deviation that he puts in his position can defeat my thrust. For instance, let's switch sides again.
Yes, sir.
We're both in full armor. He does that same thing again. Yeah, good. Go and do it again.
Skipping off of your
I got hit in the shoulder, spalder. But it hit my spalder and skipped off. Do it again. Now it hit my breastplate and stopped on my stop, my stop rib at the top of my breastplate. It doesn't take a lot to deflect the point of a sword because we are walking tanks. And once I understand that, I need to position them in such a way that they are unable to adjust their position and close off my attack. With that, we're going to go ahead and close up this episode of the PDST live stream. John, can you tell us, what did you learn today?
I giggle too much when somebody puts a sword to my throat. way too much. That's not what I learned.
We already knew that.
Yeah. What really was the interesting portion inside of this area here is think about, add more of your canoeing thought to half swording. When you are canoeing, when you're kayaking, and you're moving this stuff, what's it making your kayak do? It's making your kayak move, yeah?
Yeah.
So each time you are moving the your tool, your half sorting technique here, you're moving with it there. And that's keeping you in a constant forward or constantly in the direction you started.
Well, and that you just said something very interesting right there.
Mm-hmm.
You're not moving just forward. If we're in here and I pull my and I hit the blade in the water and I push it forward, it actually sends me this way.
Mm-hmm.
Then I come through, and then I go this way, and then this way. So I'm not moving in a straight line. And the same is true in the fight. Homie has a sword. I can't afford to move in a straight line right to him. I can't afford to get into a grapple where all things are even. If it's a fair fight, you are not trying hard enough. I can't afford that.
Yep.
So I need to put him in a position that he's weaker. And that weakness can be either structural, physical, or in time. And those are the weaknesses that I'm trying to develop in him while not letting him develop that in me. And with that, we're going to go ahead and close up this class. I hope you enjoyed this class. Half sorting is just an introduction. There's so much that goes into half sorting, and it's so much fun. But I will tell you, when you're wearing 60 to 70 pounds of armor and you start wrestling, you burn out quick. So you wrestle when you know you have the advantage. But if you don't have the stamina to do it, it's going to burn you out. So you really need to work on stamina. And with that, I thank you for joining us. Have a wonderful day. Stay safe, stay sane. And we'll see you on the other side of this. All the best to you and yours. Boom.
Great to have everybody.
Good job, man.